Hello, I'm Sanyojita. Today's video is a bit different. I'm making this entire meal for you. Paneer and cashew nut gravy, beetroot and spinach parathas, spicy green beans and potato sabzi, and bottle gourd raita. Many of you have been requesting a video on prepping and planning Indian meals. I thought I would start today with this elaborate meal, serving four people with four dishes. With this menu, I thought I'd be better able to demonstrate to you the planning and the sequencing of the subtasks involved in the preparation, rather than with a simpler meal of just a couple of dishes. After this, I think you'll be able to prepare a more elaborate menu, adding a dish or two, or a simpler everyday meal menu by dropping a dish. Let's get started then. Before jumping into the cooking process, I'm going to go through the four dishes with you and the key points involved in each. This is an important activity to do before cooking any meal. This way, we'll be able to be most efficient by planning and sequencing the subtasks appropriately. Cooking each dish serially will result in a lot of wasted time. The parathas. Task-wise, this is quite a simple process. Make the dough, let it rest, and then roll and roast the parathas. Paneer and cashew nut gravy. The gravy base for this dish has a lot of onions, cashews, tomato, and a few seasonings. The good thing is that the gravy base is pureed after cooking. So, no fine chopping, no crushing, no pounding, nothing. However, the onions need to be cooked until they're completely soft, without browning. If they remain crunchy, the gravy will be bitter. And if they turn brown at all in the process, then the gravy will be muddy colored, and we don't want that. Not very difficult to do, but it will take a little bit of time. Next is bottle gourd raita. Diced and cooked bottle gourd in yogurt with tempered seasonings poured on top. That is the tadka. The main point here is that the bottle gourd must be cooked until it's soft, and then it must be cooled before you can finish the dish, that is, add the yogurt to it. And last of all, the spicy green beans and potato sabzi. The most time-consuming activity here is to cut the green beans. Cooking the beans and potato will also take a little bit of time, but that can be done mostly unattended. Great. Having understood this, we can start cooking. I'm not doing anything at a super fast pace. I'm just keeping my normal speed with the usual inefficiencies of doorbells ringing and having to keep the trash out, etc. The time is 9:40 a.m. and although the onions in the gravy, in the paneer gravy, are I think the single longest task that needs to be done first, I'm going to start by making the dough for the parathas, because I don't want to put my hands in onion and garlic and things like that and then have to knead the dough. So first thing, we're going to get the dough out of the way and then move on to other tasks. I'm going to make both types of parathas simultaneously for the most part, because there is so much similarity between the two doughs. These parathas are savory, so they need a little more salt than the ordinary parathas. You can reduce the amount if you want. Jeera powder, turmeric is optional. Mix in the dry ingredients. I'm going to make the spinach paratha vegan, so I will use oil in it instead of ghee. And the beetroot paratha is of course not vegan, so I'm going to use ghee there. From here on out, the two doughs are going to be a little different. I knead the dough with the spinach paste. It should be warm. If you recall, I use warm water when I make my chapati dough, because the atta is stone ground and the warm water kind of softens the fiber in it. I think this much paste is sufficient for this dough. If your paste is thick, you may need to add some water. My paste has garlic and green chilies, so I have not added any other seasonings. Otherwise, you may want to add a little bit of green chili paste or some crushed green chilies. I wouldn't recommend adding red chilies because that will change the color. The dough should be soft, just like chapati dough right here. And I'm going to cover this and set it aside, wash my hands to remove all the green pieces and move on to the beetroot paratha. This one is a bit different because my beetroot paste has no seasonings at all. I'm adding green chili paste, but you can also add black pepper or red chili powder. and my beetroot paste is much thicker than my spinach paste, and I'm going to use the yogurt to knead the dough because beets have a beautiful red color in an acidic medium. My yogurt is pretty thin, so I don't need a lot of water, but if your yogurt is thick, you might need to add some more water as well. Cover and set aside. The time is about 9:52. The dough process took about 12 minutes. Next, we need to prep and fry the onions for the paneer gravy. But while I'm slicing the onions for the gravy, I'm also going to finish chopping all the onions I need for all the different dishes. In this case, I only need it for the green beans, and I'm going to do that as well. And then move on, because I don't want to have to keep putting my hands in onions. The hand smells, the knife smells, the board smells. So I just want to get that out of the way. Just more efficient to just do all the onion chopping, peeling, everything all at once. That's what I'm going to do. Slice the onions now. These need not be fine. They are going to be pureed later on. But if they are too thick, then the cooking time will be longer. So you've got to kind of balance that. But do the best you can at a reasonably fast clip. I need one onion for the beans, which is also sliced. But this one we're actually going to see in the sabzi. So it should be even and relatively thinly sliced. It only took 3 minutes to do all the onions. The time is just about 10 a.m. Now we're going to fry the onions. One has to be very patient with this. I keep repeating that, but that's important. They have to be fully soft and not brown at all. I'm just going to keep it on the low flame and monitor it on and off while going about the other activities. I'm using butter and a little ghee to ensure that the butter does not caramelize. If you want, you can use oil. And I'm going to drop the onion in before the butter ghee mixture gets too hot. Let it just cook on that very low flame. Throw in the garlic cloves. They will soften with the onion. Give it a good stir. Cover it and keep it on low heat. Next, I'm going to just finish chopping the tomato. That's the only other thing besides the paneer that I need to cut. It adds some acidity to the dish, but we don't have a lot of it like we do in paneer butter masala. The bottle gourd comes next. I'm going to dice them now and set them off to cook. I'm not pressure cooking it or anything. It's just going to be off on the stove and the back burner. So just rather get it out of the way because, as I said earlier, it needs to be cooled before we can proceed with finishing that dish. It's a couple of minutes past 10 and I'm using the other side of the bowl because there is no onion in this dish and I have a different knife. I also keep a clean cloth handy if I wash the bowl to just dry it off because sometimes we don't want everything to get wet. I'm going to dice the bottle gourd. It is going to be mashed, so we don't need to be very precise while dicing it. We have about 2 to 2.5 cups of diced gourd here. I'm going to set these to cook as well. Add a little bit of water to the pot, just a few tablespoons. The bottle gourd will release some water later. The chilies need to be fine. This is all set. I'm going to check on the onions once more and then I'm going to keep the bottle gourd to cook on the back burner. The time is 10 minutes past 10, only about half an hour since we started. The onion is looking good. It's not browning and it's almost done. We haven't started cooking the bottle gourd yet. I'm going to keep it on a low flame, move this to this back burner here and cook covered until it's soft. We almost don't even need to monitor it because there is enough liquid in it and the bottle gourd will release more. The onions are soft now and it's time to add the other ingredients to the gravy base, tomatoes and green chilies. And the tomatoes also have to get completely cooked. Now, while I can do that on a, say, a medium flame, I'm going to keep this on a low flame as well, so I can just put it off to the side unattended while I do something else like chopping the green beans. Drop in the green chilies and the tomatoes. Chilies don't need to be chopped. Scrape out the kadai and remove anything that may be stuck on it. That will blacken and discolor the gravy, and we don't want that. Keep it on a very low heat. Cover until the tomatoes are soft. I'm just going to give the bottle gourd a little stir. It looks fine, and then I'm going to move on. Over to the green beans. They need to be cut, as do the potatoes. We have already sliced the onions for this. Take off the tops and tails. Cut the beans at an angle like so, and I'm going to finish them offline. Before that, I'm going to peel the potatoes and put them in the water because I've just realized that I have to keep the trash out now. Might as well throw away the peels. I've immersed the potatoes in water to prevent blackening. Okay, the trash is out and I've also cut the beans. I'm just going to cut the potatoes into wedges and drop them back in the water. The time is 10:33. Let's check out the bottle gourd. I think it should be done by now. That way we can finish off with that, turn off the gas and let it cool. And the bottle gourd is done too. It needs to cool down, so I'm going to turn off the gas and leave it open for a while. We don't need to do anything with it for a long time. Back to the gravy base. It should be done now. It's been 15 minutes, but that time was well worth it because not only have I not had to look at it much or keep watching it, but also I've guaranteed that nothing is browned and my gravy will have its beautiful color. Everything is nicely cooked and we can finish seasoning this. Kasuri methi, it's available in Indian stores everywhere. This is as good a time as any to add the cashew nuts. The turmeric is optional. I'm a bit partial to it, so I keep adding it to everything. But if you prefer your gravy to have a pale peach color rather than the yellowish color I have, you should skip it. Now we have to let this cool and make it into a paste. I'm going to transfer it to the mixy jar and let it cool over there. The time is 10:40 and just about an hour is over and I'm going to finish the last bit of the prep for the gravy, and that is dicing the paneer. Then I can clear up all this clutter from my counter. Dice it into cubes about 3/4 inch on a side. They're not going to be identical because you can see my block has some rounded surfaces. The paneer must be soft like this and must remain soft on cooking. It must not get chewy. Now I'm going to pause the paneer gravy right here and allow this gravy base to cool so I can puree it later. And in the meanwhile, I'm going to make the green beans and potato sabzi. Get that started and then set it off to cook and finish the paneer gravy. It's about 10:45 now. Heat the kadhai and add the oil, cumin seeds, and hing or asafoetida. Add the onion. It must be fried until it's sort of golden brown, but it does not need to be fully cooked, as in the case of the paneer gravy. It will cook with the potato and beans. The salt will help the onion cook faster. The heat can be medium as long as the onion does not burn. I'm going to watch it anyway during this process. Cover and cook for a couple of minutes. The onion has cooked nicely and now we can proceed. Add the potato wedges and the dry powders, turmeric and chili powder. Add the beans and toss. Add about 2 tablespoons of water. I'm not frying the vegetables in a lot of oil, so I need water to help them cook in their own steam. While we're at it, I'm going to add the additional salt, coriander powder and cumin powder. Mix everything together. A little more water, about a tablespoon, and then I'm going to close it up and allow the beans and potatoes to cook. I'm going to block the steam vent on this lid with a bamboo skewer and move it off to the back burner so I can continue with the paneer gravy. Keep it on a low flame. There are some things in the cooking process that must be watched over,
and some that you can monitor on and off. The key in the menu planning process is to have a good balance between the two.
Now that the beans are off cooking, we can continue with the paneer dish. The activity to do here for the paneer is to saute the paneer and puree the gravy base.
I'm going to use the kadai we used earlier as is. The gravy base mixture has been cooling in the mixie jar. The kadai is hot. Add the ghee and the butter. My kitchen is warm, so the ghee is liquid at room temperature. If yours is solid, add a little less. The butter has melted. In this case, we do have to wait for the butter to melt. And add the seasonings. Cumin powder, Kashmiri chili powder, which is mild, and salt. Mix and add the paneer. Toss until excess moisture is reduced and the cubes are coated with seasonings on all sides. Here is the gravy base mixture. It is cool enough to process now, and I'm going to do that offline. The flame is medium-high because my paneer has a lot of water and I want to reduce that just until the ghee separates from it. The time is about 12 minutes past 11 and it's done.
I'm going to now skip over to the green beans. Just check them out and add the remaining seasonings and finish the dish before moving on to the paneer gravy.
I've just moved the kadai to the main burner to take a look more closely. The sabzi looks good. The potatoes and beans are cooked through. You can taste and adjust any seasonings if you want. I'm going to add some amchur for a little tang. And if you want, you can customize the flavor. I have added pav bhaji masala. But you can add any other masala like undio masala, for instance, or even goda masala. And it's done. Back to the paneer.
Just put it all together now. Add the gravy base to the sauteed paneer. Finish the seasonings and let it cook.
Now I'm going to add the gravy paste. You can see it's very smooth and it's quite thick, so we will need to add a little bit of water. This is also a good time to adjust any seasonings, and I'm also going to add some garam masala, just a little bit. I don't want to overpower the other flavors. Everything is cooked already, so we just need to simmer this for 3 to 4 minutes to allow the paneer to absorb the flavors. This is the water from rinsing the mixie in which I made the paste. Should be enough for thinning down the paste. I need a little more salt. My gravy is mango yellow in color, mainly because of the turmeric. If you have skipped it, yours should be pale peach. And I hope it's not muddy, because that means something brown earlier. And I'm just going to cover and bring it to a boil. I've kept the flame medium high throughout, because this is just for a little while. And it's done.
Now we have only two dishes left, the raita and the parathas. Bottle gourd has cooled, so we just mash it up, add the yogurt and do the tempering.
Coarsely mash the bottle gourd and green chilies. I have used a masher, but if your bottle gourd is soft enough, you can use a ladle. If you do not want to use yogurt, you can use chopped onion and some lemon juice. Add in the yogurt. My yogurt is quite thick. If yours is thin, you must remove some of the liquid from the bottle gourd. Mix it in. We'll do the tadka. That is tempering the remaining seasonings. Heat a small tadka kadhai or pan. Add the oil. I've moved it to the closer burner so it's easier to see. When the oil is hot, the hing, mustard seeds, dry red chilies and curry leaves. Give it a good stir. Fry until the mustard seeds pop. That's good. Turn off the gas and pour over the raita. The sugar is optional. I would recommend adding it if your yogurt is sour. The bottle gourd is sort of sweet, so I actually did not need any.
All our three dishes are done by, and it's just 11:30, less than 2 hours. And I don't need to make the parathas for another half an hour or so. So I'm going to take a little break.
I'm just going to garnish these with chopped coriander.
Well, while I'm on this break, I thought I'll talk to you about a couple of things. First, as you may have realized, I think, while going through this video so far, that unlike a single dish video which goes linearly from start to finish, this one kind of hops around and all the steps are intermixed for the various dishes. And so it might be a little difficult to figure out the recipe for one particular dish. I have tried to simplify that for you by just doing better chaptering, or where I use the name of the dish right in the chapter. For example, if I'm doing for the paneer gravy, you can just look at all the chapters that say paneer, paneer, put it all together, etc., and just hop across to those, and I think you'll see that particular dish from start to finish linearly. I'm also going to put the entire recipe for all the dishes in the pinned comment and the description box. I think that should be easier for you too. And the second point is that you can actually use this menu as a template for creating other menus. Just mix and match different dishes, like, you know, if you have a spicy gravy, then make a mild curry, replace the raita with a salad, have a different kind of roti depending on whether you have time to make them ahead of time or not. For example, you could make my tandoori roti instead. I have a lot of different videos. You can just mix and match in and out of this menu to create different meals. Before I head back to the kitchen to finish the parathas, I have a small request of you. If you are enjoying this video and finding it useful, do hit the like button and share it with your friends. And subscribe to my channel. It will be of immense benefit to my channel and I can keep giving you more such videos. Okay, I'll see you back in the kitchen now.
Okay, it's about 12:20 and I'm back in the kitchen. I'm going to make 10 parathas and I've already made the balls, 5 each. The tawa, a cast iron griddle, is set on medium heat. First, I'm going to start with the palak parathas. They are vegan, so I'm going to use the oil. Parathas are square, so try to shape this disc into a square if possible and roll it into a roti about 4 inches on the side. Apply oil, then fold in half. Apply oil again and then fold in half again. Shape this folded quarter into a square or rectangle. Roll it into a roti about 5 to 6 inches on the side. And drop it on the hot tawa. You can apply oil as liberally or stingily on top of the paratha as you like. It's puffing quite nicely. Flip it over and apply oil on this side. Make sure the corners and edges are cooked well. Look at it puff. And then transfer it to a cloth or paper lined box. And that's the last of the spinach paratha. One beetroot paratha. The process is the same, except that I'm going to use ghee in these. These aren't vegan. That's a beautiful color. Both these parathas look rather attractive with their rich pink and green colors. And they're a hidden source of vegetables too. What more can we ask? Last of the dishes is done. 10 parathas ready to go to the table.
Done at last. That was one long video. I hope you found it useful and enjoyable. I plan to make more such videos on menu planning and meal prep, and I would love your suggestions in the comment section below and on Facebook or Instagram. I'll be back again next week with another video. Until then, happy cooking and thank you for watching.